I was up until 4 last night listening to this new podcast called Serial.
The success of Serial is astonishing.
We're in the midst of an epidemic.
Our entire office is obsessed with a Serial podcast and now we can't get any work done.
In October last year, podcasting history was made when the first episode of Serial, an offshoot of the already successful This American Life, was unleashed onto the internet. It told the story of the 1999 murder of Baltimore teenager Haemin Lee and the questionable conviction of her ex-boyfriend Adnan Syed. It ranked at number one on the iTunes chart before it even debuted and attracted around 1 million listeners to every episode. It is by far the most popular podcast ever made.
Investigators say her body was partially buried approximately 100 yards.
Coming up this season on Serial.
I think that there are other people involved. Like, maybe he was set up. I think he was set up somehow.
Clearly you could tell something was going on that wasn't good. I mean, it was just strange behavior for anybody.
PBS News anchor Judy Woodroof called it an unexpected phenomenon. The Guardian called it a new genre of storytelling. Suddenly, podcasts were cool. More than cool, they were essential. Serial was discussed at dinner parties, on Facebook, at the pub, and during lunch breaks. Serial had marked the beginning of a podcast renaissance. Or had it? The media certainly took Serial as signalling some kind of resurge on the podcast scene. But podcasts have been around since 2004 and gaining momentum year on year at quite a pace. And although our industry is smaller than it is in the States, we've had a burgeoning scene in Old Blighty for many years now.
First podcast I ever listened to was Comic Geek Speak, which was basically, at the time it was three American guys just talking comics. And I loved it because there was one guy who I would always agree with. There was another guy who I would absolutely hate everything he had to say, and there was another guy who kind of straddled the middle, and it was brilliant, and I knew I liked it because I'm driving along listening, I'd be going, no, that's nonsense. I'd be looking at, you know, the player just yet, and I thought the fact that it can evince that kind of emotion in me, it's just brilliant.
I thought, well, this is interesting because I've always been interested in audio and radio comedy and stuff like that. Seemed to be very difficult to get into, so when I heard about this new medium, I thought this could be really good. And also Ricky Gervais had just started doing his podcasts, and I just thought, oh, interesting way of using audio, it might be able to get an audience this way.
And what do you like about the podcast medium compared to, say, other mediums?
I like that it is, for want of another word, it's radio when you want it, how you want it, in bits and pieces. You don't have to, once you've downloaded it, you don't have to be online. You can listen to 10 minutes here, 10 minutes there. You can come back to it. It's completely for you to do with as you wish. And I think that's where its unique selling point is. Also, there's a guy called Scott who does a podcast called Comic Book Outsiders. And he came up with the term, which probably other people have used independently, said it's the democratization of media. So essentially, you know, if you don't like what the big guys are saying, say what you want to say.
It's the John Dredge Nothing to Do with Anything show.
Since 2012, comedian John Dredge has been putting out a surreal, absurdist podcast called The Nothing to Do with Anything show. Each episode is a collection of sketches, usually referencing topics we're fed by the media and pop stars of yesteryear.
And there'll be another edition of Desert Island Ducks at the same time next week, when the castaway will be the ornithologist Sir Peter Scott, whose choices will include music by Van Duck Parks, Gannett Jackson, Nick Drake, and of course, this.
There's no limitations whatsoever, as far as I can see. You know, using a bit of music or a few sound effects and an unusual voice is... it can just take you anywhere at all. You know, you're not limited by pictures. The whole thing takes place in the mind.
We were talking about escapades we had hunting a vampire and a werewolf, and just recounting them was hilarious. And I think that's where a podcast comes into its own, because we had the time to indulge in our own history and our own things we found funny, which, you know, you can't on TV, because it's got to be this, or it's got to have an angle, or it's got to be television worthy. Well, it's got to be good TV. We are out and out geeks, unadulterated, unashamed lovers of sci-fi.
And that love has led us to form Geek Syndicate, which is a podcast and website dedicated to all things science fiction.
In 2014, David and his Geek Syndicate co-star Barry Nugent made the crossover from podcasting to TV and hosted the BBC series My Life in Science Fiction as part of the BBC Science Fiction season.
The British Film Institute is holding a nationwide science fiction season called Days of Fear and Wonder.
It's the things that have come about because of the podcast that are amazing to me. So, you know, you start to reach people and they start to reach out to you. And as a result, I met someone who organised a comic convention, and they asked me to host a panel with Stan Lee.
One of the most popular UK podcasts is Sony Award winner Answer Me This, hosted by Helen Zaltzman and Ollie Mann. It's been broadcasting since 2007 and is a fortnightly show in which Helen and Ollie discuss and answer questions submitted to them by the general public.
In a magnificent souvenir album, out now on iTunes.
Like many podcasts, Answer Me This is produced and recorded in a small home setup. We really are in an age now where podcasting is open to pretty much anyone, and it seems that the media, podcasting networks, even advertising companies are starting to sit up and take note. But as podcasts pave their way into mainstream media, could that rawness, that very essence that makes podcasting unique, be lost?
I think it will harm the medium somewhat, and I look back at our output from way back in the day, and there are some things I listen back to. I said, what? Oh my God, I would be crucified if I said that now. And I know that the amount of people listening, I was like, you know what, there's certain things that I used to say I could never say now.
So these are at the end of bits that we didn't have time to fit in.
Do you see the podcast industry evolving over the next few years, particularly in the UK?
I've been looking at what's been happening with YouTube lately. And, you know, I met a guy, I was on a tour of the YouTube space in London, and I met a guy whose YouTube channel gets over 11 million views. I mean, that's madness, and that's more than a lot of mainstream TV gets, you know. So people are starting to become stars in their own right within the world that chooses to watch them, and I think that is the way it's going to go, because I think it's having a bit of a resurgence at the moment. And there was a newspaper article about, you know, podcasts are back. In my mind, they never really went away, but for that article to exist means that the mainstream people who've never really taken them seriously are starting to notice that they are actually here to stay and do have quality and are good to listen to and are accepted, actually, and becoming more so.
I don't know, quite a few people are listening now, so we feel like we better try and be good.
We really can't predict where podcasting will take us over the next few years, but it's evidently a really fertile platform for creativity in the arts. Join us next time on Midweek Geek Focus, where we'll be taking a look at the retro gaming scene that is alive and thriving on the streets of London. And this is a review about The Kingsman, which I went to see last night and which I thought was so awesome.